Hi everyone, this is your 5 minute warning. The church service is going to start in 5 minutes. So if you haven't already, grab yourselves a drink, put your slippers on and get comfy. What else can they do, Tom?
Write your favourite breakfast down.
In the chat?
Yeah.
Okay, that's a good contest there. Write down your favourite breakfast to have on Daylight Savings morning.
Yep.
See you in a minute.
Bye. morning, Strings Church. Hope you've had a nice extra hour in bed.
Yeah, daylight savings time in our house hasn't existed for 7 years, ever since Thomas was born. What time did we get up this morning, Thomas?
4:30.
Gosh, I hope not. Whatever time you got up, whether it was at the crack of dawn or whether you're late, nice and toasty in bed, we hope it was fun for you. We've got a lovely morning planned. In a minute, Pete's going to come and bring us a word which we know is going to encourage you and bless you. And we're going to hear from the worship team in a second. We've got some things to tell you about, but we'll wait till after the worship for that. So, Thomas, you want
to
say it?
Over to the worship team.
Over to the worship team.
I've heard worship you. You never stop working. Even when I Hi everyone, hi Love Dudley. So here I am at the Revive Project here. It is Friday morning and we have over 20 volunteers made up of people from different churches. And we are packing up food to be delivered to families who are in need the most over this half term. These families have been referred to us from local primary schools. We have 271 individual children that we are catering for. So we are providing lunch and breakfast for every single day of half term. We're also providing as well arts and crafts materials. So I have a whole team of people just behind me over this way. Who are making up all of the arts and crafts materials and they're putting all of those together for the children. And then on Monday we are going to go live with a video and with presenters where we are going to present the gospel to families in a way that is relevant for them. We're going to tell them how much God loves them and how he's got a plan for their life. So that is really exciting. So that is Monday. It's just great and incredible that we can provide to 89 families across central Dudley at this time. So so this is the church in action, people. This is incredible. This is so good to see the church reimagined in these times. And so, thank you to everyone who has got involved.
Thanks for that worship team, that was amazing. We've got some things happening in the life of the church to tell you about this week. The first one is...
Life groups are happening this week. If you're not in a life group, get in touch with us and we'll sort you out.
Perfect. So if you're not in a life group, just email us at info@springschurch.co.uk. Did you just say, you just said that? I'm just repeating him. You can email us at info@springschurch.co.uk and we'll put you in one. The second notice is about our Gornal and Sedgley Alpha course that is happening and starting in January 2021.
Really?
It's going to be, yes, it is really. It's exciting. It's really exciting.
Cool.
Alpha course, all online.
What happens in it?
In an Alpha course, that's a great question. What happens in an Alpha course is it's an introduction to the Christian faith. You may have been watching these videos for ever since lockdown started and have wondered what all these crazy Christians are on about, and you've got may have loads of questions. Alpha is a great way to explore the answers to them with other people that are also searching. So we have partnered with churches in Gornal and Sedgley, and we're going to do an online Alpha course starting in January 2021. And what we ask you to do right now is pray about who God might want you to invite along. And if you want to invite yourself along, get in touch with us, info@springschurch.co.uk, and we'll give you all the details that you need to get involved. I think that's everything from us. So we're going to hand over to Pete now, who's going to share the word with us, and we really hope it blesses you.
Well, hey there, everybody. Thank you so much again for joining us this Sunday. It's so good for you to be with us. Can I just make a proclamation right now? I really believe that if you are watching with us today, I don't believe there's any coincidence in that. I really, really do believe that God designs it and wills it for certain things to happen at certain times. And so I want to confidently say right now that you are meant to be here. You are meant to be watching this morning. And perhaps God's got something really special to say to you. Perhaps God's got something that he really wants to excite your heart with today. Is that good? Fantastic. Excellent. Excellent. Why don't you say hello in the online chat right now and give someone a virtual high five with your emojis there. Love it. Love it. Love it. Listen, in these uncertain times, can I give you some certainties? Is that okay? The news is swapping and changing all the time and we don't know what to think. We don't know what to believe. But can I give you some certain things to hang your hat on this morning? Listen, I just want to say from the outset, I want to remind you of who God is. All things are changing in the world right now, but we can know who God is. I want to tell you this morning that God is love. God is comfort. God is the joy giver. He is every good and perfect gift. God is God of creation. He is the author and he's the architect of all life. God is healer of the brokenhearted and healer of broken bodies. He is the savior of the world. Can I say something certain this morning? Something confident. The Bible, The word of God, the written words of God, they are divinely inspired. This book is no mere book. It is the divinely inspired word of God. It is unchanging. And in every generation, despite the change in times, despite the change in culture, it is still relevant, it is still mighty, it is still powerful to change lives in this generation and all the generations to come. And this Bible has some pretty awesome things to say about you. This Word of God says the following things about you, Christian. He says that you are the head and not the tail. You are more than a conqueror. You're not just a winner. You are more than a winner in God. You are a friend of God himself. You are highly favored by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You are forgiven. You are empowered by the Holy Spirit. You are called to live an extraordinary life. That's what the truth of this word says. You are a co-heir with Christ. Your inheritance is the kingdom of heaven. What a mind-blowing thought that is. You are heavenly royalty right now. You are gifted with spiritual gifts to reach people with the love of God. Is that good news this morning? Is that good news this morning? You can trust that it is true because it is written in the Word of God. Listen, maybe you're watching this morning for the first time. Maybe you're one of the 1 in 4 people who are tuning into church for the first time over these last few months. I want to encourage you right now. Whether you know God, have faith in God or not, this is what the Bible says God thinks about you. Are you ready for this? The Bible says that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. In other words, God took time and care when he crafted you. The Bible says that you, my friend, are made in the image of God. Amazing. The Bible teaches me that you are created on purpose, by design, for a purpose. That is so good to hear. You are unique and precious, but you knew that, right? God knows everything about you. God knows every hair on your head. Do you know, the Bible even says that God knows every single tear that you ever cried and he's felt every pain that you have ever felt. The Bible teaches me that God has plans for you, my friend. Whether you've noticed God or not, he has been with you your whole life and he is just waiting for you to notice him. I hope that's encouraging right from the off. Over the last 7 weeks, as a church, we've been wrapped up in looking at the 7 signs, 7 miracles that are recorded by the Gospel of John that teach us that Jesus is no ordinary man, but he is in fact the Messiah. These miracles were signs, signposts to show us that Jesus is in fact God. Last week, we looked at the 7th final sign in the book of John, and we find that it's the raising of Lazarus from the dead. We discovered that when a person puts their faith in God, when a person puts their faith in Jesus, their soul is woken up. There is an awakening that takes place in our lives when we put our faith in God. We are literally woken up to the reality that God is with us, that his perfect love is real, and that we are risen to new life in him. Oh, it's just amazing. You know, when God's at the center of our lives, it really does start to make sense of our life, and it makes sense of our eternity. Really encouraging. These 7 miracles in John were Jesus revealing to us who he was. Your God and my God, Jesus Christ, the only Savior of the world. So the big question is this. Once you've had a light bulb moment, once you've had a revelation that Jesus is actually God, that he is actually your Savior and my Savior, the big question is this. Now what? Now what? You may have been a Christian for years. You might have been a Christian for 5 minutes. You may not even have a faith in God. And so the question for us all this morning is, when somebody finds faith in Jesus, what next? Well, you know, one day Jesus is curious. He's with his disciples. He's with his guys and his girls. And Jesus is doing miracles left, right, and center. And people are getting excited about who this Jesus is. And lots of people are wondering the true identity of Jesus. Who is this Jesus? And he says, guys, what are the people saying that I am? Who do they say I am? And the disciples retort back. Let's have a look in Matthew chapter 16, 13 to 18. Who do people say the Son of Man is? They, the disciples, replied. Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah or one of the prophets. But what about you, Jesus asked. Who do you say I am? Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but it was revealed to you by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of Hades, or gates of hell, will not overcome it. What an amazing little interaction between Jesus and his disciples right there. Peter has had a light bulb moment. People are saying that Jesus is a prophet, a good man, a miracle worker, but Peter steps forward and he says, nah, I see that you are the Messiah, the Son of God. And Jesus' response to him is this, Peter, that is amazing. On that revelation, on that understanding that I am more than a prophet, that I am more than a good man, that I am more than a miracle worker, that I am the Son of God. On that revelation, I am going to build my church. I am going to build my church. Amazing. What is the foundation that Jesus builds his church upon? The foundation is the belief that he is who he says he is, the Son of God. On this revelation, on this revealed reality, I will build my church. With this belief in Jesus, we can change the world. From this foundational revelation, I will build a people so strong, Jesus says, that this church will push back the kingdom of darkness, will push back the darkness of the devil, will push back the gates of hell. And when we bash up against the gates of hell won't even be able to stand against this church. Wow. What is the church? What is the church? The original language that this gospel was written in was Greek, and the Greek word for church is ecclesia. Everyone say ecclesia. Ecclesia. Good work, good work. Ecclesia. This word ecclesia, this word for church, it means the called out ones assembled for Christ. The called out ones assembled for Christ. Men and women and children, like Colossians 1:13 says, who he has rescued from the dominion of darkness and brought into the kingdom of his Son who he loves, in whom we have redemption for the forgiveness of sins. What is the church? The church is the assembly of those, the assembling of people who have been brought out of the kingdom of darkness and been brought into the kingdom of God's light. The church is the family of God. The family of God. Believer, can I encourage you right now? The church is you. You are the church. And you know, Jesus said, I will build my church. We sing a song in church that I am yours and you are mine. You belong to Christ today. And he says that he will build his church. That means he will build you. Right now, Jesus is building you by the presence of the Holy Spirit in you. Jesus is building you up. The Apostle Peter teaches us that we're like living stones being added daily. And there's this incredible temple of God that's been built with the people of God, with the ecclesia, the called out ones. And in those people, the Holy Spirit dwells. It's amazing. Jesus builds you. He is building you. I want to get you excited right now. Do you realize that you are part of God's master plan to save the world? I mean, we just got caught up in an incredible film script. But it's not a film script. It's Jesus' reality. You have been brought out of the world by the grace of God to reach people with the love of God. You, Jesus' follower, are God's plan A. There is no plan B. You are plan A. What does Jesus say his church are to be? Well, do you know, the first creative thing that God ever does is this. He says, let there be light. And I find it intriguing, or actually confirming, of who Jesus is. Because Jesus announced that he was the light of the world. And then he turned to his followers and he said that you are the light of the world. The first creative thing that God did was let there be light. And here he is proclaiming that you are the light of the world. Amazing. Matthew 5, 14, 16, you are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Right now, would you agree with me that our world needs hope? Right now, our world needs love. We are called to be light in the world because Jesus, the light of the world, has called us to be his light in the world. What is this light that we're going to shine? What exactly is this light that we're meant to shine? Jesus, the light of the world, he gives us insight into the light that we are to shine. Jesus quotes one day from the book of Isaiah. It's one of the first occurrences in the New Testament where we see that Jesus is prophetically revealed as the Son of God. And he quotes what was written 700 years before from Isaiah 61, verse 1 to 4. Jesus says this about himself. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners. To proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. They will rebuild the ancient ruins and restore the places long devastated. They will renew the ruined cities and that have been devastated for generations. Wow. Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me to do all of those things. And can I encourage you today, church, ecclesia, call that assembly of God. That the same Spirit that descended on Jesus is the same Holy Spirit that is sent into your heart when you put your faith in Jesus. And so do you know what our mission is? Do you know what light we're meant to shine? It's the same light that Jesus was living to shine. We live to shine by sharing the good news of God, to help and to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom to everyone who's held captive, to comfort everyone who mourns, to announce the Lord's favor. As we partner with God in such things, he lifts people from the ashes and crowns them with beauty. He brings joy. People start to praise as they are released from their despair. Where people were once weak, they will become strong because of him. This is the light that we are called to shine. Wow. Let me reiterate, the church is no building. The church is not bricks and mortar. The church building we go to meet with, that's a house where we go to praise the Lord. You, my friend, are the church. I'm so excited to tell you that this week Hope House reopened and had visitors again. People booking in that hadn't been before even. Amazing. And new friendships, broken hearts being listened to and loved on. And it's just been incredible. This is the church you're a part of. It's brilliant. Do you know the mandate for Jesus followers? Is what Jesus said himself. He said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and with all your strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. That is the mandate upon the church of Jesus Christ. But Jesus didn't stop there. In Matthew, Jesus told us what our mission was. So good. He said, go into all the world and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. What is Jesus saying? He's saying, church, we look after each other, but we must go out. We must go. We must reach out to every people group on every continent in all the world. We're to disciple them, which means to teach them, to raise them up in who Jesus is, to nurture people in the teaching of Jesus. And we're to expect ever-expanding numbers of those who are going to believe and release them to reach others. It's just amazing. Just amazing. Do you know, when I was 19 years old, God spoke to me very, very clearly about this community that we're serving right now. And this was the phrase that I really sincerely felt I heard God say. And it was this: Pete, I want one church with one heart for one community. I was like, wow, what an amazing thing. God gave us that vision. That is the vision of Springs Church. One church with one heart, one community. Pete, it's a confusing phrase. What do you mean, one church? Well, all the other churches shut down and it's just Springs Church going for it? No. All across the area that we're in right now, there are churches, men and women of God, the family of God, who are seeking God for great things in this community. And I am so excited to report that there is such a growing unity and oneness across the church, across the denominations of this immediate area. And I really believe in the truth of the psalm that says that where there is unity, God commands a blessing. I'm believing for great days. I'm believing that the church across the area will see themselves as one. Let me just tell you what that is based in. Do you know Jesus actually prayed for you? Do you know Jesus actually prayed for us, his church? In John chapter 17, verse 20, Jesus starts by saying, "My prayer is not for the disciples alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through the message of the disciples, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they," that's me and you, "also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you have sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given me to be where I am and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them." You know, God's heart is that as a church community that we would be one, more than unity, one. One in our desire to see his kingdom come in this community. And you know, not just in Springs Church, but in the church across the area, we're journeying towards a oneness that will see such an incredible wave of the Holy Spirit and such hope pour into our community. Do you know, Jesus, in a slightly different context, but nevertheless said this phrase. He said, "A kingdom divided against itself cannot stand." Do you know, church, these are difficult days, but God is on the move. And when his church are united and live as one and are single-minded about the mission that we're called to, our greatest days are now and ahead. I was talking to a wonderful lady in our church on the phone a couple of weeks ago, and she was telling me how difficult that she'd found lockdown. And it was like virtual house arrest for this particular individual. She couldn't go anywhere. She was in a part of the area where lockdown is a little more intense. But you know what she said? She said, "But do you know, seeing what God is doing with church, while the world is stagnant and while the world can't do much at the moment, it's been amazing to see how God is taking the church forwards." I was on the phone to somebody else the other day, and they were telling me how deep the darkness was that they were feeling at the moment, and just commenting on how dark the world was right now with all the different mess in the world that's going on. And I said, "Do you know what? I'm quite excited by how dark it is. Because it only takes one light to be switched on. And no matter how dark the darkness, the brighter the light. The darker the dark, the brighter the light." I really believe that we are on the cusp of a breakthrough in our community. We're on the cusp of a breakthrough in our land. These are dark days in the natural, but in the spiritual, these could be the greatest days we've ever lived. Jesus said, I will build my church. Perhaps you're watching today and you're not a Christian. You're not someone that has ever had faith in God before. But maybe some of the words that I've used today have helped you understand that the church is the family of God. The church is the people who have found that God is true to his word, that he's full of love, he's full of hope, he's full of joy, he's full of comfort. Listen, I want to encourage you today from the words of a scripture I used earlier, that you can know what it is to be lifted from darkness and brought into the light of God. I'm wondering if you're watching at home right now and you're saying, yeah, Pete, I want to step into this family of God. Step into this revelation of who Jesus is. Be part of this mission for the love of God and the love of people. Let me pray with you right now. If you want to know Jesus today, why don't you say this prayer in your heart with me? Lord Jesus, thank you that you have revealed yourself to me today. Thank you that you brought me to this place where I would hear that there is a family where I can belong. Thank you that there is something worth living for. Thank you that there is something that I can be a part of that brings utter meaning and purpose. But not just to fill my life with activity, but to receive your love and to be changed from the inside out, to be woken up to the reality of you in my life. I ask you forgiveness today for my sin. In this moment, I decide to turn away from wrong behavior, from wrong living, from things that hold me back from knowing the purity of God. I accept Jesus is the one who died on the cross for me and is the Son of God. Right now, Holy Spirit, I ask you into my life. Fill me and lead me from this day on. Amen. Amen. Amazing. Perhaps you've been a Christian for a long time and we've been out of church as it was for a long time, but maybe today has rekindled your passion for being part of the family of God. Maybe today has put in you a new steel, a new passion, a new fire to be part of everything that God wants to do in this community. Let me just pray for you. Father, I thank you for my brothers and sisters, since that's what they are. Thank you for the family of God. Thank you for calling us out to reach people, God. Father, I pray today that you would anoint us with new vision for who we are and what we are to be in this community and in all of the communities that we're from. Father, I pray that there would be an unbridled passion for your name and a great, great desire to see men, women, and children won into the love of God. Use me, God. Help me, Lord. I want to live for you. God bless you, church. Thank you so much for being with us today. Pray that you're very, very blessed. And we will see you soon.
Thank you for that, Pete. That was amazing. We really hope it's blessed you and encouraged you. And in fact, if anything in the service has challenged you and you want to talk about it, please scan the QR code in the corner of the screen and it'll give you all the details that you need so that you can get in touch with us and we can help you on your journey. Don't forget then, this week it's life groups. Don't forget, life groups are happening this week. If you don't know what day or time yours is happening, just get in touch with your life group leader and they'll be able to remind you. And now over on our YouTube channel, what's happening, Tom?
Kids church.
Kids church. All Yay. The cool kids are going to be there, aren't they?
Yeah.
So get yourselves over there, kids, and you'll see this week's kids church video.
Except for me, because I'll be at church.
Except for Thomas, because he might be at church.
But that's not fair. I want to be at church.
Good. Well, that's very fair.
No, I want to be on kids church.
We'll watch it when we get home.
Aww.
Okay. Anyway, thank you everyone for tuning in. Have a great week and we will see you soon.
Take
bye-bye.
Take two. We're not doing that.